How do you do?
Hello.
What's the matter, mister?
Oh, we had an argument and he pulled a knife on me, so I shot him.
Do you mind if I...
No, go right ahead. Plenty of room.
They were funny in the movies. They were... They were funny in the movies. They were funny on stage. Groucho Marx, Harpo Marx, Chico Marx, Zeppo, Gummo. But the three most famous were Groucho, Harpo, Chico. And they made us laugh.
Am I crazy or are there only two beds here?
Now, which question do you want me to answer first, Henderson?
And 8 pieces of French pastry.
There's 2 hard-boiled eggs.
And 2 hard-boiled eggs. Make that 3 hard-boiled eggs.
That's what they call a sanity clause.
You can't fool me. There ain't no sanity clause.
In the 19-teens, nicknames that ended with the letter O were all the rage. I mean, my name's Bob. Someone might have called me Bobbo, and that would have been my nickname. And the Marx Brothers were actually playing a game of poker with a comedian, a monologist named Art Fisher. And Art Fisher was one of those guys who liked to give people nicknames, and they tended to stick. So during this particular poker game, which I understand was backstage at some vaudeville theater, Art Fisher was handing out cards to the brothers and giving them all nicknames at the same time. So Adolf, who later changed his name to Arthur, became Harpo for obvious reasons, played the harp. Chico, and it was pronounced Chico, not Chico. The brothers always called him Chico. His real name was Leonard, but he was dubbed Chico because he chased the chickens, which we now might call chicks if we were politically incorrect. And Julius became Groucho because of his rather grouchy disposition. There are other stories that he used to carry something with him called a grouch bag, which was like a man's sort of purse to put things in, and that a lot of vaudeville actors carried around at the time. But I stick with the former story, that he was named after his grouchy disposition.
Your check, sir.
$9.40? This is an outrage. If I were you, I wouldn't pay it.
Groucho's one-liners, and Groucho's attitude, and Groucho's crouch when he walked, and his wiggling cigar. All memorable to people who are movie buffs. Chico, on the other hand, mangled the language in what he considered Italian. I don't think it was Italian. I don't know what it was. I think it was Chicoese.
Friends!
Talk fast. I see a man in the crowd with a rope.
How we happened to come to America is a great story, but I don't tell that.
All he did was add to the end of words and act dumb when Groucho tried to convey a simple truth to him, like, if Groucho said it's raining, he said, well, that's a fine boss. Non sequiturs.
Say, I just remembered. I came back here looking for somebody. You don't know who it is, do you?
It's a funny thing. It just slipped my mind.
Groucho was my close, very close friend. But the love of my life in terms of the Marx Brothers was Harpo, who was the dearest, sweetest man that ever lived. And I loved his comedy. I was thrilled any time I could supply any of his comedy to him. He was creative. He played the harp very well. He played piano. And I think his contribution to the Marx Brothers was invaluable.
What's interesting about the characters is that they're so clearly defined. And I mean, they are almost cartoons. So they almost are like, you know, Mickey and Minnie or Daffy Duck or something. I mean, they have created these, even just the silhouettes of the Marx Brothers, it's like Alfred Hitchcock, you know, you recognize the silhouette. So in a way, it's almost like they trademarked themselves so that they became more than just a comedy team. They each one of them sort of was a brand.
You recognize those icons right away. What's interesting is you think about, somebody had to come up with that. I mean, somebody had to think, you know, I won't talk and I'll wear this wig and I'll wear a raincoat. And how did those characters form, and it's interesting. And of course, they all sort of evolved over time. It wasn't, Groucho didn't automatically put on the eyebrows and the mustache. That grew out of a sort of a stock comedy character of the time called the Dutch comedian. Harpo's character was sort of based on a stock vaudeville character of the time, and dialect comedians were very big during vaudeville, so Chico became an Italian dialect comedian. But there's something about these three disparate characters that somehow come together and work so well. It doesn't make sense that these three characters would even hang out together, and yet when they're together, something really magical happens.
You know the old saying, two's company and five's a crowd.
The first two pictures that the Marx Brothers did were film versions of the Broadway shows, Coconuts and Animal Crackers, which were shot in New York, and those were basically stage plays that were put on film with some embellishment. They were really film comedy's first anarchists, in that if you look at comedy before them, let's take an example of somebody getting a pie in the face. I mean, there was sort of crazy comedy that happened at the time, but it was always motivated. But the Marx Brothers, although they didn't literally really throw pies, they would sort of metaphorically throw a pie in someone's face just because they felt like it.
Peanuts, peanuts, get your fresh roasted peanuts, folks. They're nice and hot and cold, they all get your peanuts. Be all peanuts. Ah, peanuts, peanuts.
They just did crazy things for no reason other than there was this sort of anarchic spirit in them that made them want to do these things.
We embrace these characters because they have the ability to say what everybody else is thinking but afraid to say. For some reason, they're courageous in a way, courageous cowards. They don't use a gun or a sword. They use their mouths.
Now, what have you got to say to me?
Just this. Can you sleep on your stomach with such big buttons on your pajamas?
Then they came out to Hollywood, and they did Monkey Business and Horse Feathers and Duck Soup, and those were the Paramount films.
You know, they were taken right off the stage. They were adaptations of their stage plays, and there were more vaudeville turns, variety shows, with more like years later, Hell's a Poppin' with Olsen and Johnson, that were just madness and chaos.
And Duck Soup, at the time that it came out in 1933, it bombed at the box office. And the Marx Brothers actually thought their careers as film comedians were over. Zeppo dropped out of the group, decided he had had enough, and they were floundering for a while and thought that they would not be able to make movies again. Groucho was even for a short time considering getting out of the act and letting Chico and Harpo go on as the Marx Brothers. But lo and behold, Chico got into a bridge game with Irving Thalberg, who was the boy genius at MGM. He was only in his 30s, but was ostensibly running the studio. And MGM at the time was the prestigious studio in town. I mean, Paramount knocked out some good comedies and had a good track record, but MGM was the prestige studio to be at. Not seemingly where the Marx Brothers, these kind of ragamuffin comedians, would belong. But Chico, who was a terrific card player and not such a terrific gambler, was in a bridge game with Irving Thalberg, and Thalberg started to talk to Chico about the boys coming over to MGM. And it happened. They wound up with a contract at MGM, and the first picture was A Night at the Opera.
Now we're getting somewheres.
At this time, 1934-35, audience tastes were changing, and Thalberg understood that.
And A Night at the Opera, thanks to Thalberg, who was this, you know, this genius about creating the right atmosphere for the right actors. He was absolutely terrific at that. He structured it so that it was a movie that they would like in Elephant Breath, Wyoming, as much as in New York City.
Thalberg thought their past pictures were fine, but they were just kind of silly, and he thought that the pictures at MGM should be anchored with some sort of dramatic storyline. You can look at the storyline of A Night at the Opera and conceivably do it as a drama. I mean, what's funny about it is the Marx Brothers.
And it was very structured. It did have a love story. It did have a beginning, a middle, and an end.
And the Marx Brothers, all their craziness was going to be geared around helping the young lovers achieve whatever it was they needed to achieve, so that there'd be some rooting interest for them. There would be bad guys in the movies who would sort of stand in their way, and then it would look like the Marx Brothers were going to lose out, and then at the end, finally, they rally and they get what they want, and they help the young couple.
Wait a minute, please. Wait a minute. It's before he sings, you got to sign a contract, and I get 10%.
Yes, and I get 10% too.
Yes. The It had much going for it. It had opera going for it. It helped introduce classical music to people in small towns that were starved for that sort of thing or didn't know that that sort of thing even existed.
There were almost always musical numbers in the Marx Brothers' past films, but now there were going to be these lavish MGM-style musical numbers. The brothers respected Thalberg, especially Groucho, who even in his later years would look back and refer to Thalberg as a genius and that he was the best thing that ever happened to their careers. And so he really changed the kind of movies they made. He changed their whole style.
They loved Thalberg. They loved being at MGM after being at Paramount for so many years. They loved the whole setup, and they were kind of in their cups in Hollywood. They were no longer New Yorkers. They were really belonging to Hollywood. And I think that their youth and their enthusiasm and everything all kind of came together on that film. And it shows on film.
Tonight at the Opera and A Day at the Races were the biggest successes financially that the Marx Brothers had.
Also, Night at the Opera is a classic case of an establishment that's so pompous, so stuffy, that when you really go after it, as they did, you get pay dirt.
The last place you would expect to see the Marx Brothers are at an opera, and that's why that film is so brilliant, I think, bringing their sort of anarchism to something as staid and uppity as the opera.
Well, anything that you think is funny about an opera house, you just look at this movie and they did it.
The Marx Brothers' earlier pictures were based on their Broadway shows, and a lot of the routines were honed in vaudeville. So Thalberg had this idea of returning to the roots, of returning to the stage. So what they did was brilliant, was they took the key comedy scenes from A Night at the Opera and A Day at the Races, and they made a vaudeville tour of it. They played several cities, and they played these comedy scenes, and the writers were often in the audience, or studio people were in the audience, taking notes about what got laughs and what didn't get laughs.
So they get a really good indication of what was funny and what wasn't.
They would change it from city to city, from performance to performance, and hone it and polish it.
I mean, it was a great experiment. Nobody had ever done that before, I don't think. But that was Irving Thalberg again at MGM.
Groucho told me personally that he never really thought much of their films until they made the two for Thalberg. They felt that they were being treated in a way they'd never been treated before, where story mattered, structure mattered. I can't say character because they were who they were. But he felt, I think firstly they felt very complimented that this wunderkind of the motion picture industry had deigned to work with them, you know, although they were not above, you know, sitting naked in his fireplace when he was late one day.
So they had an appointment at 1 o'clock in his office. So they all went in the office, and he was late. He was an hour late, he was 2 hours late. When he finally came, the Marx Brothers, and I mean specifically Harpo, Chico, Groucho, were naked. They had taken all his wooden furniture right near the fireplace, and they built a fire, and they had sticks, and they were roasting Mickeys. In New York, that was called a potato. And he walked in his office and saw these naked men, and they were the biggest stars in the country, if you understand it. Everybody was laughing at the Marx Brothers. And Thalberg saw this situation, had a potato, and was never late again. Isn't that nice? Now, I didn't have an appointment with Thalberg, you know what I mean? But if he does come now, I'm ready to give him an omelet. Buck, 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 buck.
And you, Ricardo, how do you feel?
After a meal like that? Great. Why, I could sing my head off.
Glad to see
you. Oh, si, cosa. It's a wonderful word.
After the Marx Brothers did their five pictures for Paramount, Zeppo dropped out of the act, and the Marx Brothers became Groucho, Harpo, and Chico. And Zeppo just sort of felt he was tired of having to be the straight man and being the young romantic lead, and it was a pretty thankless job when you're on stage or on camera with those three brothers, so he had had enough. And so in A Night at the Opera and A Day at the Races, Alan Jones ostensibly played the Zeppo part. And in A Night at the Opera, Katie Carlisle played opposite him.
Alan Jones was a darling. And he had such a beautiful voice. We had good times together.
And what was it you wanted to see me about?
Oh, I suppose I sent for you.
Well, you meant to.
And I loved Alan Jones. I wanted to be him. And alone, alone on this night that we two could share.
But I will still remember the happiness we've known.
Oh, well, I was cast in A Night at the Opera because my friend, Oscar Levant, took me to see the Thalbergs. And we went there for a dinner one night, and apparently he sold me to the Thalbergs, and Mr. Thalberg was the executive producer of A Night at the Opera. And that's how I got the job.
And Kitty Carlisle does her own singing, which is pretty phenomenal. I mean, she plays an opera singer in the film, and she's singing. You're actually hearing her voice.
Alan Jones and I had to pre-record the music, and then the first scene was a huge scene with a lot of extras because I was singing at the Metropolitan Opera, and I was singing Pagliacci, and I started Ridono lassù libera, and I stopped. And Sam Wood was up on the boom, and he said, "What's the matter, kid?" And I said, "I don't know, Mr. Wood." He said, "Okay, take two." Off we go. Stridono lassù libera. And I stop again. He comes down to my level, and he says, "What's the matter?" I said, "Mr. Wood, that's not my voice." He said, "Well, just go ahead and sing it, and we'll explain later." And something told me not to do that. So I went to my dressing room, leaving all the extras and the stagehands and everybody, and I called my agent. And he called me back, and he said, "Get dressed every morning, be ready for work at 8 o'clock, and we'll tell you when to come out of your dressing room." So I've waited 3 days. I held up production 3 days. And finally, Mr. Thalberg called for me. And I went there, and I cried on his waste paper basket, and I cried on the top of his head, and I cried on his desk. And when I hear the Miserere, that high C is mine.
You know, you have Groucho, who's sort of the man of the world, but he's kind of a bumbling man of the world. You know, he's always unsuccessfully trying to seduce women and trying to be very cosmopolitan and sophisticated, but, you know, he usually kind of fails miserably at it.
He would come up to me every once in a while, and he'd read a joke deadpan, and he'd say, "Is that funny?" I'd say, "No, Groucho, that's not funny." He would say, and then he would read it funny. And I'd laugh, and I'd say, "That's funny."
And then you have Chico, who is, you know, Italian for some reason. Like, why? He's an Italian immigrant.
Chico always amused me because he was the phoniest Italian that I've ever heard.
"You got some mail for me?"
"Mail for you? You don't work here." "All
right, then where am I going to get my mail? I don't work any place."
And then you have Harpo, who is just kind of like the id. You know, he's just like the completely unleashed part of someone's personality, you know, where he wants to eat, he wants to chase women, you know, he adores music. He's just completely this fawn-like character that's like the spirit of Pan or something like that, even with the hair.
At 11 o'clock, he would lie down on the nearest piece of furniture and yell, "Lunchy! Lunchy!"
Bringing Margaret Dumont into the mix was a contribution of George Kaufman, who wrote their first two Broadway shows, co-wrote the first two Broadway shows, Coconuts and Animal Crackers. And again, Kaufman and Maury Riskin came back as writers for A Night at the Opera. And again, that was Thalberg's idea of sort of getting them back to their roots and their best films, is by surrounding them with the best writers and the people that the Marx Brothers were comfortable with. And they loved George S. Kaufman. And prior to his entering the picture, the Marx Brothers were just these sort of ragamuffin comedians who would just run around and be crazy.
Well, you know, in those days, they were knockabout comics, and they weren't really, quote, the Marx Brothers.
And it was Kaufman's idea to put this sort of socialite, this sort of proper woman, into the mix so that they'd have somebody to bounce off of.
Hello, Tits.
Well, what are you doing here? This is Mr. Gossip's box.
Margaret Dumas was the perfect foil-less for Groucho and the other two maniacs because she played it perfectly straight. Supposedly, she didn't even know where the comedy was, and that just played perfectly because she could remain very in the moment while they just destroyed all the moments around her.
She's a very straight woman. Apparently off-screen, she was pretty much the way she was on-screen, and Groucho always insisted that whenever he would throw some double entendre at her, that she really didn't quite know what the meaning was. And I guess that's part of her charm, was that she was playing who she was.
Well, you know, everybody thought that she didn't know what she was doing. Margaret Dumont was an old actress who had been doing summer stock and stock in New York State for a long time. Believe me, she knew what she was doing. They weren't pulling the wool over her eyes. That's why she was so good at it. I don't think she could have done it that well if she hadn't known what to do.
Wonderful. She was absolutely marvelous. I mean, there wasn't the Marx Brothers picture unless Groucho was leering at her or dipping into her pocketbook or threatening to or promising to. She was wonderful.
And I welcome you all on this, the final night of the voyage.
Well, what's interesting about Walter Wolf King's character, Laspari, in A Night at the Opera, and again, this was typical of sort of the Thalberg formula, was he was really interested in gaining rooting interest for the Marx Brothers. And one way you do that is you have some villains who are being very nasty to the Marx Brothers, and then, of course, your allegiances will be with them, which allows them to get away with their irreverence because they're doing it for a good cause, and they're the good guys. And there's that scene in A Night at the Opera where Laspari is literally beating Harpo in his dressing room, and he actually whips him at one point, and it's awful. It's actually a little bit uncomfortable to watch. I mean, you feel terrible for Harpo. But then later on, they can just tear apart Laspari, Walter Wolf King, and that's okay, because you've seen what this mean guy did to Harpo.
Nice work. I think you got him. Ah, smelling salts. That'll bring him to. You're sorry for what you did, eh? That shows a nice spirit. Now he's coming along. Yeah, he'll be fine now.
Once you get a storyline, and Thalberg was very smart when he said, let's give the Marx Brothers a storyline. And what it did was it enhances anything that you see. Kitty Carlisle and Alan Jones were legitimately in love, legitimate singers. They sang an entire aria. And it helps the movie. It helps the sandwich. The whole evening is a sandwich, the whole movie. The nourishment of the plot and the two slices of bread, which is all the humor, makes it a delicious sandwich. It really is. Excuse the reference to food. But to me, a story is like a good sandwich.
You can't fool me. There ain't no sanity clause.
A couple of scenes that I occasionally flash back to that amuse me and, of course, the audience were one, the scene where Groucho and Chico start talking about a contract.
Then he said, the party of the first partner, and then they don't like that part. And the party of the second part, they don't like that part. And then they go on and on.
By the time they get through ripping out all of the codicils of the contract that were in originally, they wind up with the last one, where Groucho says, well, this is the one we have to hold on to. This is the sanity clause. And Chico says, there ain't no sanity clause.
There's no sanity clause, I think, was the funniest moment in the show. It was hilarious.
People were screaming at that.
They just stood and delivered like two vaudevillians would on a stage.
The basis for what they're doing precedes vaudeville. It certainly precedes movies. It's right back to Roman comedy, two Romans meeting on the street and engaging in a dialogue. That's theater stripped to its essentials. I mean, other than a monologue or a pantomime, which is even more difficult, it's two people exchanging words.
It says the party of the first part should be known in this contract as the party of the first part. How do you like that? That's pretty neat, eh?
No, it's no good.
What's the matter with it?
I don't know. Let's hear it again.
It says the party of the first part should be known in this contract as the party of the first part.
That sounds a little better this time.
And again, the language almost becomes the establishment, and the attack language as a sacred form or medium that is also subject to their kind of attack. You know, they take sanity clause and make a nonsense out of it, you know?
It was a perfect little routine, perfect routine.
I'm the engineer's assistant.
You know, I had a premonition you were gonna show up. The engineer's right over there in the corner. You can chop your way right through.
One of the great comedy scenes of all time, almost up there with Charlie Chaplin eating the cooked shoes in the Gold Rush, is to me the stateroom scene in A Night at the Opera, where over a period of hilarious minutes, this small cabin on the ship becomes packed with humanity.
Once you've seen it, you can't forget it. And I think any time that you're in a small space with a lot of people, that, you know, somehow there's some echo of that scene that starts to come up for you because it's just so classic. And I think that what's great about it is the way it just keeps piling more things on top of other things.
And you see where it's going right away, and you're just, oh, who's it gonna be now? And then somebody knocks on the door, and you're just anticipating, how can any more people fit into this little room?
I wonder if those walls weren't a little bit expandable. I don't know. I wonder if in several takes they didn't help a little bit, but who's to quibble? It's wonderful. And again, there's some tension there. He's waiting for Margaret Dumont to come, and instead of being alone and you know, doing what he wants to do with her alone, he's got, did anybody ever count how many people were in that room?
I don't know, it must have been about 20, 15, 20 people. How many were there?
There may have been 20 people.
37.
57 people.
God knows.
Must be 15.
Groucho, the food!
Been waiting all
food.
Afternoon for
he
you.
Comes to the food.
Come on. There's a saying about drama in general, comedy or otherwise, you know, always put your hero in the last place he wants to be. Well, he was in the place he wanted to be, but it became the last place he wanted to be, because how was he going to entertain, you know, Margaret Dumont with all these bodies, literally bodies floating around? So they were clever. It wasn't just joke, 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 joke. They had a purpose an agenda for all of those block scenes is what they are.
What's interesting about it is that everyone in the scene continues with the reality of whatever their job is that they're supposed to be doing. So the guy that's there to, like, check the heating tries to do it. The manicurist tries to do her work. The waiters come in and they attempt to serve.
And Harpo ends up sleeping on the tray.
That's the soundest asleep any human being has ever been. That's the one. That's the subtlety. That's the extra icing on the cake, as they say it.
It's all magical. It's all magical and wonderful.
And it's like a complete little story all unto itself, and hysterical.
And it is probably the funniest single shot ever done in a movie.
The stateroom scene to this day is considered one of the great set pieces of comedy in motion pictures.
Well, looking back on doing this movie, it has made my reputation with my children and their friends. The fact that I was in A Night at the Opera with the Marx Brothers makes me a notch higher than anybody else's mother. And that's the best that I can tell you.
Their comedy has withstood the test of time. I'm not sure why. I see W.C. Fields, I see Mae West, I see people who were genuinely funny people. The Marx Brothers, genuinely funny. And you can look at the movie and laugh today as you did then, but we laugh even more now. We're in awe of the freedom.
They did what great artists do, which is instead of doing what everyone did before them, they did something different and subsequently changed everyone who came after them. I mean, they really reshaped the art form of film comedy.
It's wonderful that the Marx Brothers movies are able to be seen. For the older people, it's a wonderful piece of nostalgia. We really will remember who we were and what we were doing at that time. And for the young people, they'll say, oh, this is what my parents laughed at. Oh, well, that's why they have a sense of humor.
If they're still popular today, and they are, certainly not as widely, perhaps, but it's because the stuff holds up. It's because the material holds up, because artistry doesn't go out of style.
The world has changed. We've changed. Humor has changed. We've seen so much humor since then, but we still laugh at what they did.
You know, some of the jokes might seem a little clunkier now, or maybe some of the references a bit arcane, but I mean, it's the difference between, they use copper plumbing. I mean, what they did has a durability that doesn't diminish.
There are just so many different levels of humor and styles of humor within the same grab bag of a movie that could be one reason why they've lasted so long. Because there's sort of something for everyone, no matter what your taste is.
And there's always the establishment that they were always against. And so as long as you have three people trying to tear down the authority or make fun of it or embarrass it, that's going to remain constant and will attract newer fans or viewers.
And that's the beauty of video and DVD is you can see films that are 60, 70 years old and watch them on your TV anytime you want and see what kind of movies were being made a long time ago that have influenced a lot of current comedy.
Those movies are time capsules, and they've proven over, probably with the vaudeville experience, maybe near a century of having an appeal to old and young people. And that's their legacy, that they go on and on and on.
I know they're going to be around long after a lot of us are gone. And as Groucho said, hello, I may be going.